Welcome to Biochemistry Boot Camp. Again, like I said, my name is Nick Fitzke. I appreciate y'all showing up. Hopefully everybody got some handouts up here at the front. If you've been following the website, they're all posted there too. And so we have a couple of days of hopefully good stuff for you. Particularly those of you who's undergrads? Raise your hand if you're undergrad. So, and of those undergrads, how many of you have taken a biochemistry course? So really only one. And so for you guys, there's probably going to be a lot of new information here. Rest of you graduate students? Yeah? So the graduate students, you know, you're probably going to see a lot of review, particularly for some of the DNA and the protein sessions. But hopefully there's good stuff for you too. And so, you know, we're aiming for a target audience, and I realize that means that not everything is going to be great for everybody. But hopefully we can hit somewhere in the middle where there's something for everybody can learn something from this. We're recording it for the first time this year on video. And so hopefully everything works well. Don't expect that to go up immediately because, one, I've never done a recording like this before, and it's my understanding it's going to take a lot of time to produce it and put all the sound and stuff together. But hopefully it will be of reasonable quality, so if you feel like you missed something, you can go back and catch it later on. You know, certainly at any time during any of the sessions, I'm doing a lot of them, but for when the grad students do the sessions too, don't feel like you have to, you know, wait till the end to ask questions. You know, the idea here is for you guys to learn and to get information and to you know, maximize your experience. And so everybody I have teaching sessions, if it's not me, I'm confident in their ability to answer questions or at least direct things to me or somebody else if they don't know the answer. So. Don't be afraid about that and speak up. Our first session will be a review for those of you, or I guess the one of you who's had biochemistry before. We're going to talk a lot about protein structure, mainly because a lot of the tools that we're going to talk about throughout the rest of the session or the workshop is going to be relevant or looking at properties of proteins. And so hopefully this will be a good review and new exposure for some of you. Our presenter for the first workshop is Dinusha. She's one of the graduate students in my lab. She's the most senior grad student I have. So she's been doing this for a while, and I know she knows proteins. And so please give her a round of applause, and let's get started.
Today I'm going to do the protein structure lecture. So actually this is for undergrad students and also for others. This can be a reminder for protein structure, basic protein structure things.
Is it working?
Yeah, it should do in the on the laptop. It's not here.
No, yeah, it's on the laptop.
Okay.
All the stuff has been run off the laptop.
Yeah. Okay. So first thing is the different representations of protein. So as you all know, maybe the building block of protein is amino acid. So simply we can show the amino acid sequence of the protein. For example, this amino acid contains around 56 amino acids. So we can simply show the amino acid sequence. And also, the top picture is showing the secondary structural elements of the protein. So for example, first around first 8 residues are in beta structural element. And also this red color region is some alpha helical element. So we can simply show in a 2D figure, we can simply show the protein structure. And also we can show in a 3D manner. This is called cartoon model. From Pymol software, we can get these cartoon models. In here, we can see all the secondary structures and also all the bonds in a 3D structure. So this is the building block of protein, amino acid. So in here you can see all the, there are 20 amino acids which can form proteins, and all these 20 amino acids contain same backbone, the middle carbon called alpha carbon, and there are four groups attached to this alpha carbon. First one hydrogen, and amino group, and a carboxylic group. And these 20 amino acids differ with the with this side chain or the functional group, except one amino acid. What is that? Glycine. Because glycine has hydrogen here, so these two are similar. If not for all the amino acids, this alpha carbon, this is called alpha carbon, is a chiral carbon, because all these four groups are different. Okay. So another thing you have to remember, these charges of these two groups, amino group and the carboxylic group, should change according to the pH of the solution. Okay, if we are in a low pH, like acidic medium, this should be NH3+, this should be COOH. When we increase pH, this which one is more acidic, NH3+ or the carboxylic? This part is the acidic one, low pKa. So this will ionize first when we increase pH. So this will go to COO-. Okay? This is still NH3+. So when we go further, when we increase pH more, this will also reduce the hydrogen and it become NH2. Okay? Yes?
Can you
show
them a bit about that? Like at low pH, what charge?
I just wanted to... If you want, I can draw it. Okay, at low pH, can you see here?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Low pH means,
okay,
suppose we have more H+ in the solutions, okay? So, which means all these are hydrogenated, full with hydrogen, both groups, okay? COOH and NH3+, full hydrogenated form. So, when we increase pH, which means adding a OH- to the solution, then this one is the most acidic one, carboxylic group. So it will ionize first. So it will form COO-. It will remove this hydrogen first. Okay. Then when we go further, when we increase more, this NH3+ group remove the hydrogen and form NH2. And you have to memorize other things. Some R groups, functional groups, also contain some ionizable groups. If those groups can ionize in between these two steps, those also can ionize. Okay? So I just mentioned here the main two groups which can ionize here, but later you can see some ionizable side chain groups. So if those having pK values in between these two, those can ionize in between those two pK values. Okay, so these are, then we can move to the 20 amino acid structures. Okay, so if you are in a biochemistry field or you are in the same field studying protein, you all have to memorize all these 20 amino acid structures with this with the name and also 3-letter code and also from 1-letter code. When someone tell you like THEOF, you have to draw this structure if you are in the biochemistry field. Okay. So the to memorize, we have different methods to memorize. We always stick these 20 amino acid structures in front of our lab, so our desk, to memorize all these structures. So The simple thing is we can group these 20 amino acids. By grouping, we can memorize those easily. Okay? So first group is nonpolar amino acids. So nonpolar means these R groups, as I mentioned earlier, this functional group is nonpolar here, and this side chain is uncharged at neutral pH, and those side chains cannot participate in hydrogen bonding because these are nonpolar. For example, in alanine, this CH3 group is the functional group, so it is a nonpolar group. And this glycine hydrogen is the nonpolar group. So even we, you can see, even we group this glycine and alanine as nonpolar groups, those two nonpolar groups are very small atoms, like hydrogen is a small atom. But these two polar groups, carboxylic and NH2 groups, are bigger groups. Sometimes we cannot tell exactly whether glycine is nonpolar. Like these are on the fence. Like these polar groups are very smaller. So these two are polar, NH2 and COOH. But sometimes, mostly we group alanine and glycine as a nonpolar groups. And also, you can see these nonpolar groups are like different. For example, when I memorize, I always start from glycine. Glycine, CH3, alanine, and leucine, and also isoleucine, like that. So for methionine, we have a special sulfur atom here. And phenylalanine is a special nonpolar amino acid because it is contain a large aromatic group. Okay. So then next group. Next group is polar amino acids. So you can see all these as R groups are polar. Polar means these are uncharged at neutral pH. These cannot have a charge. But these can donate or accept hydrogen bonds. So these are from light dissolved light stearate. These can dissolve in water. This can form hydrogen bonds with water because these are having nitrogen, oxygen, sulfur groups. So these can form hydrogen bonds with water. So which means dissolves in water. So from here also you can see these polar groups are very different. These are having very huge differences. So for example, asparagine is having amide group, C double bond or NH2. And cysteine is another special amino acid. It is having a thiol SH group. And this glutamine, C double bond or NH2, asparagine and glutamine. The only difference is asparagine is having 1CH2, glutamine is 2CH2. These are the things we can easily memorize. And also imidazole. Imidazole is another special ring in histidine. And serine containing OH group, serine and tyrosine. Tyrosine also, it's a phenol group. Okay, all these are, you can see, all these are polar groups. So these can dissolve in water and form a water soluble part of the protein, water exposed part of the protein. Okay, so as I mentioned earlier, when I was drawing this one, I mentioned some side chains can ionize. So these are the side chains can ionize. Okay? For example, there are some side chains can form negative. Negative charges, some side chains can form positive charges. So the negative charges having two amino acids, aspartate and glutamine. So for aspartate and glutamine, both having C double O minus group, only difference is 1CH2 and 2CH2 groups. Asparagine 1CH2, glutamine, aspartate 1CH2, glutamine 2CH2 groups. Okay, so and this pK value is 3.9 and 4.1. So as I mentioned earlier, when we ionize this amino acid. So we have another carboxylic group here. So when we ionize this this aspartate group, first we can see this carboxylic group will ionize, and then secondly this group will ionize, then at the end NH3 plus group will ionize. Okay, that's what I mentioned. If there is an ionizable group, it will also ionize in this process. Like if the pH, all these things depends on the pH of the solution. Okay, and also other positive charges. So positive charges containing guanidium in arginine, this is called guanidium. But these positive charges are delocalized positive charges, not only on the stably on the one atom. It is delocalized positive charges. Imidazolium ring. So this is a special amino acid. Why? According to this pK value, can you see what is the special thing in this amino acid? Because this pK value is the only pK value closer to the neutral pH, pH 7. So at neutral pH, some percentage of this side chain can be protonated. So this is the only amino acid contain a side chain which can protonate around the neutral pH value. Okay. So other amino acid is a lysine. So it has a long CH2 chain, four CH2 groups, and also NH3+. So, but these pH, you have to memorize one thing. Even we can tell these pK values when we consider just the alone, this amino acid alone, these amino acids, the pK values can change when it is within the protein. For example, if this lysine group buried inside inside a hydrophobic cavity, when it is covered with the hydrophobic groups, this pK value can shift. And for example, if this is closer to any negative charge, this pK value can change. Okay, so it can easily form, it can easily ionize. So then pK value shift. So you have to memorize that. According to the just, when you consider just one amino acid, we can tell these are the pK values. But this can change when it is in the protein 3D structure. Okay, now you can see this is the standard method. We can show the 3D structure of the protein. Okay, so always negative charges, we can show negative charges in red color, and blue color is the positive charges. So all these negative and positive polar groups, also those are water soluble or water hydrophilic groups. So those are always outside the protein in 3D structure. And these white color areas are neutral or hydrophobic groups. Those hydrophobic group always buried inside the protein. So now you can understand, from all these different amino acids, we can form different proteins. So that's why in our body and in our plants and in whole world, there are different amino acids with different characters. Okay, so that's how these different 20 amino acids form different amino acids with vastly different characters. Okay, now we can move to the peptide bonds. Okay, so first we discuss about the amino acids. So those are just amino acids. When those amino acids form proteins, those amino acids should connect with each other. Okay. So as you know, maybe you know polymers. For polymer, they have same building block for everywhere. Okay. So like whole polymer contains same building block. But for protein, it is very different amino acids, connected very different amino acids with different functional groups. So for example, if you are considering two amino acids containing different R1, R2 groups, when they form this peptide bond, it is always called condensation reaction. Why it is called condensation reaction? It is forming a water molecule here. So when this COOH group and an H3 plus group connected to each other, it will remove water molecule and form this peptide bond. Okay, so this is the special peptide bond. So what is the special character when you compare with C alpha C and CNH? What is the special character of this CN bond here? Because you have two lone pairs on this nitrogen atom. So since we have two lone pairs here, these electrons can delocalize on this CN bond. So this is not clear, this is not a completely single bond. This has a partially double bond character. Okay, so that is a special character of this peptide bond. So that's why we cannot rotate around this bond easily. From organic, you know, when there is a partial double bond or partial double bond character, those bonds cannot rotate easily as single bonds. Okay, so that's why this peptide bond we cannot rotate easily. So, and this nitrogen called amide nitrogen, and this carbon is called carbonyl carbon. So this carbonyl carbon can accept hydrogen bond, and also this NH2 hydrogen bond donor group. Okay. So then you can discuss this. What's the advantage to having 20 amino acids? You can discuss with each other. Even you don't know everyone yet, so you can talk with your neighbor and discuss this question, and then you can tell me your answers. What's the advantage to having 20 amino acids? Okay, now you can tell me your answers. What do you think? What's the advantage to having 20 amino acids? Medha, would you like to tell me something?
Just like increases like variety of like proteins.
Yeah, that's what we. Yeah. So anyone else?
Amino acids have the different functions, so it's advantageous to having the 20 amino acids together.
For example, that's why for the protein I'm analyzing, it's called PINMA. So that protein is having a special character. It has two domains, binding domain and the catalytic domain. So it should have, for binding, it should have a special amino acids in the binding domain. And to catalyze the isomerization, it should have a positive charges to bind with the negative phosphate group. So it's a very different protein. So like that, for example, another thing, keratin, our hair contains an insoluble protein. So to make that type of protein, we need water insoluble amino acids. So and pepsin, it is in a gastric juice. Pepsin is a very acidic amino acid, so it needs acidic amino acids to form that type of protein. So there are vastly different amino acids proteins. So that's why we need these 20 different amino acids to form different proteins. Okay, now first we discuss the chemical characters of the protein. So chemical structure of the protein. So now we are moving to the backbone structural features of the protein. So this picture is showing the backbone of a protein. So in this backbone, you have to understand how this backbone forms. So this blue color is the N group. Here, if you are not clear, you can see this one. So this is the N, blue N, and H is the white color one. And gray color is C alpha and C double OH, two C groups here. C alpha is the one connected with the functional group, and another one is the C double bond O group. This red color The red color one is the oxygen in C double bond O. And white color ones are hydrogen, two types of hydrogen. The H alpha mean connected to the alpha carbon, NH mean connected to this nitrogen. So this directionality is N-terminal to C-terminal. So you have to understand, even you don't have this C double bond A OH group and NH2 group here, you have to understand what is the directionality. How you can understand? Because you have to memorize this order. You have to understand the order. So when it is N-terminal to C-terminal, N-C-C, N-C-C, there is an order. And you have to memorize which C is the first one. This is C-alpha and C-double bond O. So when you go from here to here, that order is different. Okay? Even you don't have this NH2 and C double bond O, you have to understand which directionality of the of this peptide, polypeptide chain. I forgot to tell that. Polypeptide chain. When you make that two amino acid, it is called peptide. So when you have two amino acids, we call it dipeptide. Okay? So when you have more amino acids, we call it polypeptide chain. Okay? So this is a polypeptide chain. N-terminal to C-terminal. And you can see this is the backbone. N-C-C, N-C-C, this is the backbone of the protein. And these side chains are added to the backbone. So this is the backbone of the protein and these side chains are added to the protein. So even this is showing similar R groups, those R groups are different. So according to those R groups, this amino acid chain, this polypeptide chain change. So this picture is again showing the backbone of the protein in a different way. So in here now also you can understand the directionality, N-terminal to C-terminal, N-C-C, N-C-C. So this red color one is the peptide bond and these are the side chains. So this in blue color box, you can clearly see the backbone. This is called backbone and these side chains are out from the outward from the backbone of the protein. So now we can move how this, now we know how this protein form very simply, how no amino acid connected to each other to form a polypeptide chain. But proteins are very complex. Okay, so in proteins, protein is not just a polypeptide chain. It is having different bonding in between the protein, inside the protein. So this is the first slide to show how this polypeptide chain form hydrogen bonds. So you can see this naming pattern HIOI minus 2. Can you understand this naming pattern II minus 2? Like when you consider this HI, this is the HI, okay? So when this is NH group, this is NH C double bond O. So this is C alpha and C double bond O. This is a one amino acid, okay? C alpha and two side NH and C double bond O. This is a one amino acid. So this is the next one. This is the next one, okay? So which means this one is, if this is ith one, it is connected with the I minus 2. Okay? Did you get it? So when you name this amino acid as a ith one, ith amino acid, so this is the C alpha carbon and this is C double O one and this is NH2. This is a one amino acid. Okay? This is the another one. This one is the another one. This is C alpha H, NH2, C double bond O. This is the next one. C alpha, C double bond O, NH2. So this is the, when you consider from here, this is first one, this is second one. Okay, so that's why it is called HIO minus 2. It is connected with the HI, connected with the O minus 2. Okay, like that. So this HIOI, this is in the same amino acid. So even we consider this one as a just a 2D structure, this is actually not, we cannot see this is like a simply, okay? So it is always having some angles. I can show you it later. So from that angle formation, it is very hard to form hydrogen bonds in between these two, even those are closer. In the 3D manner, it's very hard to form hydrogen bonds in between these two closer groups. Okay, that's why it is called too much strain, HIOI. Okay, and also HIOI plus one, it is not showing here. Yeah, there is a, that is another one. And HIO minus 2, this one, HIO minus 2, this is also very rare, but it is possible in gamma terms, HIO minus 2. And frequently observed one is the beta terms, HI and O minus 3. So from this figure, you can understand how it is rotate and form hydrogen bonds. Okay, so that's why these are frequently observed hydrogen bonds. And in here you can see those are non-repeating backbone patterns, because these are not having any patterns. So those are not repeating backbone patterns. Those doesn't have any pattern. But these are having patterns, HII minus 4, HII minus 4. Those are having patterns. So these are the repeated hydrogen bonds. These can be repeated in the polypeptide chain. And these repeated hydrogen bonds can form alpha helix. And also HII minus 4, OI minus 4, hydrogen bonds can form gamma turns also. And still you cannot understand these phi psi angles. We can discuss it later. So these phi psi angles are minus 60 and minus 40 when it is formed alpha helices. Okay, now so far we discussed alpha helices. Then the second one is beta turns. So when it is formed beta turns, the direction reverse. So you can see this N to C, but this direction reverse when it is formed a turn, okay? And when it is formed a turn also, these some groups become closer, and this C double bond O and NH can form hydrogen bonds easily, okay? So this is also N to C terminal, N to C terminal, and it form a turn. So when it is forming a turn also, we can form, it can form a special hydrogen bonds in between C double bond O and NH. Okay, now you can understand from all these hydrogen bonding patterns, you can understand how these right-handed alpha helix form. So this is the actual structure of the polypeptide chain. We cannot see a polypeptide chain in a 2D manner. So this is the actual 3D structure of the alpha helix. So now you can understand which groups are connected to each other. Like this C, NH and C double bond O is in a closer manner when it is formed an alpha helix. Even now you can understand this one, the same similar group in a similar amino acid, C double bond O and NH cannot form hydrogen bonds easily in this 3D structure. So this is the alpha helical, right-handed alpha helical structure. Okay, now we discuss alpha helical structure and also beta turns. So these are called beta sheets. So when the beta sheets form, in here you can see these two, there should be a two polypeptide chains to form beta sheets, two closer polypeptide chains.
And these two polypeptide chains are in a similar direction, N-terminal to C-terminal, N-terminal to C-terminal. That's why we are calling the parallel beta sheets. When those are parallel and close enough, we can form, they can form hydrogen bonds in between this OH, 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 like that. And you have to think these hydrogen bonds are inclined, not direct, these having inclined hydrogen bonds, okay? We can compare this one with the next one, okay? So this one is called anti-parallel beta sheet. N-terminal to C-terminal, this is C-terminal to N-terminal, okay? So then, when we have this anti-parallel beta sheet, it can easily form hydrogen bonds, not inclined. It can easily form hydrogen bonds. So what do you, which one is the stable one? What do you think? In here you can see these hydrogen bonds are inclined, and also this can form hydrogen bonds, two hydrogen bonds in one amino acid. So this should be the most stable one. So anti-parallel beta sheet should be the most stable one, most stable hydrogen bondings here. Okay, and also you can see there are some angles, special angles for this one also. As for the alpha helix, we have special bonds for shy phi angles for the beta sheets also. And this sheet should have a distance, closer distance to form the hydrogen bond. Okay, now we can move to the dihedral angles. That's what I call phi chi angles people. So when you understand this dihedral angles of protein, this is little bit complex. So we can start from a small molecule hydrogen peroxide. So when you explain this hydrogen peroxide molecule to someone, what do you need? What are the things you need to explain? So you need, what are the atoms first? You have two atoms, two oxygen atoms, two hydrogen atoms. The other thing you need is the distance between 2O and OH. You need bond length. And also you need angle between this O, OO and OH bond. Okay, now you need three bond angle and also bond length. Okay, the other thing is the angles between these two planes. When you consider these two bonds as planes, then you need another angle between these two planes. These are two planes. When you consider these 3D planes, you can understand how clearly how this molecule form. So the angle between these two planes called dihedral angle for H2O2. So like that, we have dihedral angle in protein backbone also. As I mentioned earlier, what is the special character of this C-N bond? It is having partial double bond character. So it's not easy to rotate this bond. So this omega angle is always 0 or 180. It's not, it cannot rotate easily because of the partial double bond character. But these two bonds, N-C alpha is phi angle, C alpha C double bond of psi angle. So these two bonds can rotate. So as I mentioned here, these because of the rotation of these two bonds, it can have different dihedral angles according to the plane of these two bonds. Okay. So these two special bonds are called phi and psi angles. Okay. When you understand the 3D structure of the protein, so you can clearly see the planes here, phi, psi planes here. So when you understand this 3D structure clearly, you can understand all these angles are not possible. Okay, you cannot form all the angles in between this phi and psi because of the spherical strain. Those atoms can hit each other, spherical strength. So we cannot have all the possible angles in between psi and psi. There are some stable angles for psi and psi for different secondary structures. So in Ramachandran plot, it is showing sterically allowed psi and psi angle. Okay, so this is a study done by the Indian scientist Ramachandran. So in this figure, you can see which angles are the possible angles without spherical hindrance. For example, in here you can see this is a phi psi angle, and these are the 0 to plus 180 minus 80. This angle 0 to minus 80, 0 to plus 80. Okay, so for example, alpha helixes are always in this range. So this angle is in this range and phi angle is in this range. Okay, so these are the possible angles for alpha helix, and this is left-handed alpha helix. This is rare, but short helices can happen in the protein structure. And these are the common structures, alpha and beta sheets. Okay, these are the possible sterically allowed regions, and these white color regions mean these are not allowed. So those white regions are disallowed because of the steric clashes. So which means these angles are not allowed in this region. And okay, this figure is showing the reverse Ramachandran. So when he draw that Ramachandran plot, he considered a peptide containing three amino acids. Okay, he just considered that three amino acids and take the possibilities. But in this figure, you can clearly see what are the steric clashes. This is reverse. So white color area means the allowed region, and the colored area means disallowed regions. So this, but at the previous figure, we can just see white color region, those are disallowed. But we don't know what are the steric clashes there. But in here, you can see what are the steric clashes in the peptide. So these are the steric clashes. In red color area, these two are the steric clashes. Okay, and this orange color area, these two are the steric clashes area. So in here, we can clearly see which in these three, the amino acid, in between these three amino acids, which atoms can form, can have a steric clashes when it is having these angles. So white color area means the allowed region here. That's why we call it a reverse Ramachandran. Okay. So the actually this is a computational study to determine which structures are allowed in that protein structure. So this picture is showing a actual data for a protein. So in this actual data, you can see these dotted are mean the allowed possible places. So in this figure, you can clearly see this beta, alpha, and left-handed alpha is not having very dense area, but these two areas are very heavy area. So which means this should be the normal computational data when we done the Ramachandran study for a protein. Okay, now the second question. Why might you see violations to the Ramachandran plot? You can discuss with each other. You have to talk with each other. You have to introduce yourself. You don't know others' names. So then discuss why might you see violations to the Ramachandran plot. Okay, shall we discuss your answers? Just tell me your answers. We can share your answers. So,
your answer? I don't know. Justine, can you share your answer? Don't have answer. Yes, Matt.
So there are functional random coil sequences that might not be available in the Ramachandra plot as defined up here. There's also other structural motifs, there's Greek keys and barrels that won't be in the Ramachandra plot.
Yeah, that's also correct. And it's this here, they just think theoretically. It's not, but energetically, it's very different. Naturally, it can be different. Like when we have glycine, like small side chains, it can be different. And also when we have in a row, if we have very sterically hindrance side chains, so it can be different. So those are the times we can disallow this Ramachandran protein.
Yes.
So remember the theoretical basis of the Ramachandran plot assumed that proteins are made out of hard spheres, and atoms aren't hard spheres. So if you have electrostatic attraction, you could maybe force those two atoms closer together than what they might be otherwise. And so, because atoms really aren't hard spheres, and there are energetic considerations like Dinusha mentioned, the Ramachandran plot is a good set of guidelines, but occasionally you do see it violated. And often when you see it violated, if you look in the PDB or the structure, which we'll get to later in the course, you'll see that, oh look, there's a reason that it's violated. It really wants to put two atoms close together because there's some energetic benefit to it.
You mean unknown mean unknown
like
everything?
Like if you're working in a protein something and you need to analyze using
this. Normally, some proteins initially can analyze from the Ramachandran and then we can determine the secondary structure very easily from Ramachandran.
Okay, now we can move to the hierarchy of the structure, protein structure. Okay, so this hierarchy proposed by Lindstrom Lang, the scientist, and this picture is showing his laboratory in Carlsberg. So this is the scientist who proposed this hierarchy of the protein structure. So what is the organizational steps of the protein? Primary, secondary, tertiary, quaternary structures. So these are the, but you have to understand this is just organization. He introduced the organization of the protein. We cannot see primary structure separately, secondary structure separately, tertiary structure separately. It is just explaining the organization of the protein, okay? So these are the steps of those hierarchy. First one is the primary structure. So first thing is you have to memorize this is the organization of the protein, okay? So we cannot see these separate structures in a protein separately. So primary structure. Primary structure means the sequence of amino acid. This is the simplest one. Sequence of the amino acid. So from here you can see these amino acids are alanine, isoleucine, phenylalanine, and also lysine, histidine. So these are the amino acids here. So this is form a polypeptide chain. These different amino acids form a polypeptide chain. So this is called sequence of amino acid. This is the simplest structure of the protein. So this is called primary structure. And the secondary structure. Secondary structure means we have to consider about the hydrogen bonding. So as I mentioned earlier, these polypeptide chains can form hydrogen bonds between atoms. So when these form hydrogen bonds, it can form alpha helices, beta strands, and turns. So we discussed this everything earlier.
So when we consider these hydrogen bonds in these structures, we call it backbone hydrogen bonding or the secondary structure. So these are the secondary structural elements, alpha helices, beta strands, and turns. These are the secondary structural elements. So we can show these secondary structural elements as a cartoon model. So this is the standard cartoon model for the alpha helix and the beta turns. Okay, this is a standard way to show alpha helices and beta turns. So these are called cartoon models. We can get these cartoon models in a PyMOL software. So then you have to think whether we can draw a protein or the actual protein is just like this or like this. Which one should be the correct one? It should be this, like this. So that's what we need, the tertiary structure. We cannot just show the protein structure as a 2D structure. So actual protein structure is a 3D structure. Those, even they have a secondary structural element, alpha helices, beta sheets. All those secondary structural elements are also forming another bonds and forms tertiary structure. Those secondary structural elements are also interact with each other in this tertiary structure. This is called three-dimensional coordinates. So these are the three-dimensional structure of the protein. Where these are having different bonding patterns in between different secondary structural elements. So this is the actual tertiary structure of the protein. In the quaternary structure, we can see this is the complex one, the last one. So these are the complexes of multiple proteins and multiple chains. In these two different colors, you can see two different protein chains. So actual proteins are having different domains, different number of proteins. Some proteins are forming dimers in between two similar structures. Some proteins are having two domains. Some proteins are having more than one polymer chain, like not dimers. It may be a polymers. Okay, so like this, this is the quaternary structure of the protein. So complexes of multiple proteins. Okay, the final question is, does it make sense to think about one type of structure being more important than another? When we consider the hierarchy of the protein organization structure, primary, secondary, tertiary, quaternary, does it make sense to think about one type of structure, for example, secondary structure, is more important than the other, another? Does it make sense? You have to discuss. Okay, what is the simple answer? Does it make sense? Do you have explanation for that? Why you say? Just share your answer. Yes.
Yeah, equally important.
Because we just consider as an organization. We need every level to make a protein structure. So it does not make sense to think about one type of structure is important. We need all the structure. That's why we, I mentioned at the beginning, we cannot discuss protein as a first, it has primary, secondary, tertiary separately. It's a complex of all the structures. So it does not make sense to think about one type of structure is being important. Okay, so at the end of this lecture, I'm going to summarize the things we discussed. Proteins are chemical chains made up of 20 different amino acids. So if you are in a protein field or biochemistry field, you have to memorize all the 20 amino acid structures. Okay, and the three-letter, one-letter symbols with the names. and the chemical structure of the backbone has consequences, helices, sheets, and turns. So now you know how to form hydrogen bonds in between the helices, the atoms between in the helices, beta sheets, parallel, antiparallel, and also turns. And protein structure classified into four level hierarchy, primary, secondary, tertiary, quaternary. So these are the, this is the summary of our lecture.
Okay, thank you.